great to be here this morning with all of you. You know, we call our church the Gathering, and I don't know if you ever reflect on that word, but the name of the church kind of came out of us just changing the idea of what this is. You know, old church language would have been, we're going to the worship service this morning. And in our culture today, that language doesn't really work anymore. So we started calling this the Gathering. We're a gathered people. God calls us to gather together. As we follow Jesus, we do that together. Jesus called people together, and gathering is being together. So as we come here each Sunday into this space, we get to gather as the people of God. We get to gather as a family. We get to gather as a community. We get to gather to focus our attention on Him. We get an opportunity to prepare ourselves for the coming week. I don't know if you've ever heard this word before, but those of you grown up in the church would know that the order in which we do things in church used to be called the liturgy. How many of you have heard that word before, liturgy? Yeah, it was just an order to what we do. And if you go to some churches even today that are still very much in the tradition of the liturgy, you can count on it. You come in and it's always this way. And for many of us, it's like, oh, I don't like the regiment of that. But if you follow Jesus long enough, you begin to discover that there's great beauty in that, the order of things. And so there is a reason to the order in which we do things as we come in here. So we have established some new rhythms, is a better word I like to use, when we come to gather in this space. Obviously, we walk in the door, there's George. Praise God for George. We love George. Coffee. Right? You hear that, George? That applause is for you. And then you get a bulletin. The bulletin is just to provide us with information so that you have that. And some of us are in the digital world, and some of us are still in the printed world, and so we have that for you. And then as you come a little further in, we have some stations in the back. And for many of us, this is maybe a new concept, but we've created some freedom back here so that as part of your worship, it's not just sitting, you're actually doing, you're actually getting up and going. So the first station back there is just the offering box. We have a box back there. Instead of passing a plate around, which has so much stuff attached to it in terms of people's experience in church, when we come in, we get to give God back what He has blessed us with. And we get to do that through our tithes and our offerings. And so there's envelopes back there. There's a little comment to reflect on. And then there's the treasure box that Terry made. Now, many of you have been trying to negotiate the treasure box. And you fill up, you go look at it, and it blends in so well you don't see it. But there's a slot in the top. So you don't have to open up the box and figure out how to open up the box. You can just drop it in there. So know that that's part of our worship as we come in. Then we have another table that's just filled with candles. We've had it in the past. It used to be in the back corner. And it's just our Persons of Peace table. It's the people that we're praying for to come to know Jesus, the people that God has placed in our lives. And if you feel compelled to, you can go over there and you can just light a candle. And there's a prompt there that you can pray for people in your life. And know that as you go back there and you see candles lit, those candles represent people. They're not just candles. So maybe you don't have a candle to light, but you could go back there and just pray for those candles, knowing that there are prayers behind them. And then lastly, we're just going to have this back there all the time, a communion table. We do it in a rhythm here as a whole community, but we don't do it every week. But that table's back there for you to go take a piece of the bread and dip it in the cup. And again, there's a prompt. So please feel free at any time to go take communion. And sometimes it's a great place to start to prepare our heart as we come into this space. So anyway, those are three areas in the back that I just want to direct us to. So as we continue to worship this morning, for my devotional time this morning, I was in Isaiah 43. And many of you are starting to follow the devotional readings that we have in Moravian. You downloaded the app on your phone, and it just takes us through the Bible in 2 years. And I'm blown away as I spend time in the mornings quiet with my journal, my cup of coffee, and God's Word, how it speaks into my life every day. We're going to start talking about identity more today. Listen to the words of the prophet Isaiah. It says, "But now, O Jacob, listen to the Lord who created you." Now let me tell you a little bit about Jacob, just a little snippet. Jacob and Esau, you know the Bible story? Jacob wasn't satisfied with the birth order in the family. He wasn't going to receive the blessing. And And so he had some issues he had to deal with in his life. Jacob's also the guy who, says in Scripture, wrestled with God. He wrestled with God, really, over his identity and who he was. So let me read that line again. "But now, O Jacob, listen to the Lord who created you. O Israel, God's people, the one who formed you says, do not be afraid, for I have ransomed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you go through deep waters, I will be with you. When you go through rivers of difficulty, you will not drown. When you walk through the fire of oppression, you will not be burned up. The flames will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior." So I don't know what you come in with today. All of our hearts, all of our lives, and mind, body, and spirit, we're all different places right now. But you need to know the one who formed you is watching over you. He's taking care of you. And he's going to navigate through this season with you, whether it's on the high or it's the low. Many of you have already expressed to me that you're exhausted. We just had a holiday and we're exhausted. That doesn't make sense, right? Holidays are supposed to be refreshing. Know that the Lord our God is with us in this season. And that's worthy of being reminded about and knowing that we will come out on the other side. Just as Isaiah said, he is our Savior. So let me pray. We'll sing a couple of songs maybe that can lead us in the right direction. These can be prayers. These can be reminders. These can be responses. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for being our Father. You're the one who created us. You are the one who knows us better than anybody does. Lord, we thank you for the gift of Jesus. We thank you for the life that he lived, the life that he gave, and his victory over all that we struggle with. His victory on the cross so that we can live today. Live amazing lives today if we just live into that. And we thank you, Father, for the gift of your Spirit. Your Spirit that's here right now with us. Your Spirit that is in us as we live our lives each day. Oh, Lord, you know the condition of our hearts this morning. You know what's going on in our minds and even in our bodies. And so, Lord, I just lift all of that up to you. I want to entrust you with that. I want to entrust you with everything that we're struggling with, personally, communally, nationally, and in the world, Lord. I want to lift that all up to you. And I want to surrender that to you and trust you with it. Trust that you are really at work. Trust that you will redeem it. Trust that you, in the end, will redeem, fix, and restore everything to the way in which you intended it. May we have hope. May we have hope because of who you are and who you created us to be. For this in Jesus' name, amen. We've seen this one a lot. those words from it. I am a child of God. He chose you. He chose me. He chose us. We are all children of God. We are His kids. We are His family. Creator of the universe. The one who is over all. The one who is in all. The one who is always at work. Always at work. Even when we can't see it. God, our Father in heaven. Lord, we thank you that we can look to you as a perfect Father. Lord, may we understand the depth of those words, that we are your kids, we are your beloved children. May we live into that identity. Praise Christ's name. Amen. All right, so before we sit, we're not going to move away from this. There are people around the room that need to be welcomed and met by you. And so you're going to go to somebody in the room that you don't know well, or maybe some of you haven't seen in a long time, and you're going to say hi, and then you're going to ask them, so what brought you joy this last week? Ready? Set? Go! Thank you.
seconds now.
All right, let's start head to back. Gus is going to come out the door announcement this morning.
So, we have some kids in the house. So, come on up, girls. I want to pray for you as you guys set up. good to see your first name. It's really loud for everybody because there are many people here who don't know you. So what's your name?
Riley.
Okay. And what's your name?
Carmen.
Carmen. All right. So we're going to pray for these guys as they go out. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for these two, Lord. We know that you love them and care about them. I pray that as they go, Lord, that they would learn more about you. And as they learn more about you, it would make them feel really good about who you created them to be, and that they would discover more and more what it means to follow Jesus. Your goodness, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. I think Peter needs to get a new iPad. I guess that technology starts to age out. I got this iPad in 2012, and it's been a reliable friend, but now it's not anymore. All right, so a couple of things before we dive in. First of all, we're going to be in Ephesians chapter 1 today. So if you have a Bible, or you're using your Bible app on your phone, feel free to pull that up. We're going to be in Ephesians 1, and in our pew Bibles, that would be page 977. So it's towards the back. And I want to mention, I mentioned devotional thing this morning, just what I shared from. If you're not following with us on this, I encourage you to do it. We use the daily readings from the Moravian text, and it's just a way to read through the Bible, structured over a two-year period of time. So in 2 years, you'll read through the whole Bible. And to have a nice, simple app you can put on your phone that has just simple readings and a prayer for the day, or you can actually read the scriptures that they prompt you with. You can go to the website if you want and have an email sent to you. The information is in your bulletin. You just go to Moravian.org. But I was talking with one of you who's been following Moravian, and they made the comment, they said, you know, Peter, you know, as I'm reading along, I get Genesis and Matthew, and we're moving along, and then I start to get in these books, and I have no idea what's going on. You know, I start reading about in Jeremiah and all this stuff, and I don't know where it's all coming from. And I said, oh, I got a book for you. So this is in your bulletin also. So if you're one of those people, you're reading the Bible, and you're like, I don't get what's going on, there's this great book, and I've been using this. I just got it, and it's a great book. It's called How to Read the Bible Book by Book. And it's written by Gordon Fee and Douglas Stewart. It's paperback. You can get this on Amazon. And seriously, when you get to that book, you're like, okay, I got Genesis, and I got through Exodus. But Leviticus, I don't know. And you can go right here, and it'll give you some background. So I highly recommend this. So if anybody wants to take a look at it today before you go, I'll just leave it up here. All right, and then last thing, races. So I said we were going to move away from this. Jesus called us to love our neighbor. And we started doing this, and we're not going to stop doing it because we're called to do this every day. And we're really not doing it because we expect an outcome, although I know that God works when we pray. So we're going to pray for our neighbors this morning. Take a moment to do that. But just remember the word bless. In order for us to love our neighbor, it begins with prayer. Begin praying for them. Just begin to pray for them. Expect conversations to come up, which means now you're not going to talk to their lives. You're going to listen to their lives as you get to know them. Then the E stands for eat food. And I know many of you are living into that, where you're taking, baking a little more, a few more cookies and putting them on a platter and delivering it to that neighbor, or even inviting them into eating moments. And I'm hearing some stories from you guys already that that's starting to happen with you and your neighbors. Then the two S's is looking for opportunities to serve, an opportunity to serve your neighbor, do something for them. When you're on your way out, maybe headed to the store or whatever, just throwing that out, going, hey, I'm on the way to the store, can I get you anything on the way? But you may find that they actually want to come over and help you with what they're doing. And then the last one is S, last S is for story. The idea that as you build relationships with people, there's your story and their story. They're starting to connect. And something may happen in their life that you've experienced, and all of a sudden, Jesus, God, in your life becomes a part of their life as you get to join that story with them. So let's just take a minute and pray, and if you don't have one of those bracelets before you leave today, you can grab one of these. Remember, we're praying literally for the people who live right around us, behind us, and then praying for the people that are in our lives every day, because some of us have four or five people that work with us every single day. So let's pray. Lord, I want to thank you for the people that you place in and around our lives. Lord, we lift them all up to you. We pray that your grace so many of us haven't been together over the last couple of weeks. You might not have even been able to live stream with us, but our live stream's been all over the place, I think, for the last month, and I apologize for that. We're still working on it. My phone is actually doing it right now. So, again, I apologize for that. But I want to get us all on the same page in terms of what we're talking about right now. So, the last 2 years of our lives have been extremely disruptive, right? I think we can all agree to that. And I think for most of us, we're done with it. It's like, I want this to be over. I'm totally done with it. I'm ready for it to return maybe to the way it was. And if that's not the case, I want it to become whatever it needs to be. But many of us are really getting frustrated with it. And it is hard to live in these moments where we're in between. It's the now and not yet, some different language that I've used. In all of this waiting and hoping, all the unknowns, words like a gap in our life right now, a canyon, a mountain that's in the way. Last week, some words I used were this idea of a pause. For many of us, this is just exhausting. It's just exhausting. It's been very frustrating. It's been very disruptive. In some of our lives, it's been divisive. It's been discouraging, depressing, confusing, you name it, right? So last week I shared how this season for leaders in this church and myself, how this has been for us. So Phil and Eric and Susan and I, you know, as we've tried to plan, like, what do we do? What do we do and how can we do it? I mean, the TGF thing we're even doing today, we're sitting down trying to do the what to do and how to do it kind of stuff. And in one of our leadership team meetings, the last one actually, we were talking about what to do next. And Phil and Eric and I were all about what to do and how to do it. And we're discussing, and Susan's on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, Zooming with us and just listening. And we get to the end of the meeting, and one of the things we do on our leadership team at the very end is we always say, what did we hear today? And again, Eric and Phil and I were thinking through, you know, I think this, but it was all what to do and how to do. And then Susan says, the word I'm hearing is preparation. Preparation. Preparation for maybe what God's going to do next in us and through us. Preparation. And it was kind of one of those mic drop moments. Especially for me, because I'm trying to figure out what we can and cannot do. What would be the right thing to do for us right now? Especially with a two-year gap, a gap of time. So what I always do is I look to Jesus. And that's what we talked about last week. We went back and we looked at, what did Jesus do? What did he do to prepare for ministry? And if you recall the story, and the one we looked at was in Matthew, Jesus got baptized, and the Spirit came upon him. And he heard these words from God, his Father. You are my Son, and I am pleased with you. And then the Spirit leads Jesus into the wilderness for 40 days. And he goes through that whole thing. 40 days, 40 nights without food, without water. And in his most vulnerable moment, the enemy shows up. Shows up. And this time in the wilderness is actually this time for Jesus before he does what God has called him to do some work. To do some work. He is a human being. He's God's son. He struggles with life just like you and I do. And yet God has placed a high calling on him. And he knows who he is and he knows what his calling is. But he has to root himself deeply in it for what lies ahead. And so the enemy comes to him and hits him right where it starts. He's been fasting. He's hungry. And the enemy says, you know what? Why don't you just turn this into some food and satisfy your hunger? And Jesus says, No, I don't need to take the things of this world and turn them into things that I need for myself. God's enough. And then the enemy says, you know, this obviously isn't working out the way you probably planned. You know, you're out here in the wilderness all these days. This is what God called you to. Why don't you get up here and jump off and start to take life into your own hands? Why don't you start to make some things happen? Let's kick this off. And Jesus confronts that and says, no. God has a plan. God knows what he's doing. test that, I'm going to be obedient to what he's called me to, and that's not a plan. And then he goes to the third one and says, you know what? You're probably not feeling really good about yourself right now. So if you'll worship me, worship the things that I'm about, here's what we'll do. I'll put you in front of everybody, and you can be who you are, and people will adore you, they'll celebrate you, and they'll worship you. And Jesus says, no, 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 this isn't about me. This is about my Father in heaven. This isn't about me. This is about my Father in heaven. And right after that, the Spirit takes Jesus out of the wilderness and he begins ministry. Jesus had to work on his identity. Jesus had to work on his identity. This last week I was gone for 5 days with my wife. And for Betsy and I, we use this as a time of retreat. And people ask, so, what do you mean? It sounds like you went on vacation. You're using this word retreat. What does that mean? Well, what Betsy and I do with that is, yeah, there's fun in that, but we're literally going unplugged. And we were really remote where we were. And in this beautiful cabin, someone had gifted us with a house, this beautiful place. And this is what we do with it. We rest. We're tired. A lot of sleeping, a lot of napping. But we do that so that we can take the time and pause and reflect. So a lot of reflection. So I took some time to reflect on the past year in terms of what God's been doing in my life and the way he's been growing me. And then in that reflection time, I start to write some things down. I start to listen to what I'm hearing because God's speaking to me. And I take the time to read. So I'm taking the time to read, I'm taking the time to listen, and then I take the time to ask God, how do you want me to respond to what I'm hearing? So I've been sitting with Jesus' time in the wilderness. Appetite, ambition, and admiration. Those were Jesus' three temptations. The appetite to make myself feel better. Do whatever I can to consume to make my life feel better. Ambition. What are the things that I want to see happen? What are the things that I want to see happen? And what do I need to do to make those things happen? And then affirmation. I need some approval. I need to know that people are liking me in the midst of all of that. I had to fix those three things myself. And as I mentioned last week, there's these underlying things that I'm having to acknowledge in my own life. There are these emotions, these feelings that we can go to when we're trying to take life into our own hands, when we're not liking the way it is. And I mentioned those words last week. Fear, guilt, and shame. I don't know about you, but I've lived with a lot of fear over the last couple years. I have, you know. I'm trying to shepherd a community just to be your pastor. There's so much fear and failure. Do you realize how much fear there is in failure of me not being able to live up to what I need to be in this moment? And the crazy thing is in that fear, guess what? When I'm dealing with that fear, I want to run away from it, so I go to my appetites. And for me, I'll be honest with you, I'm doing a lot of TV. Binge watch stuff. So for a moment, I can get away from it. The funny thing that happens is I do that. That's a waste of time. And I know in my head that's a waste of time. So then I get this other feeling, guilt. The very thing I'm doing isn't the thing I should be doing. Sound familiar? The Apostle Paul said that, I think. Why is it the things that I want to do I don't do, and the things I don't want to do I do? And out of guilt can come shame. Out of guilt can come shame. And we live in that cycle of fear, and the way we respond to that, and the guilt, and then shame, and we just live in the tension of that, and the enemy just uses that, and then it pushes us back towards our appetites, and it pushes us back towards wanting to take life into our own hands, and all of that. And it's this endless cycle. It's this endless cycle. Decided, what if God is not enough? What if I'm not doing enough? And what if I'm not enough? to ask a question that will prepare ourselves to be who God's called us to be. For us to be able to do the things that God has called us to do. Things that will be done in us, things that will be done through us, the things that He desires. And it begins in me, and it begins in you, and it begins in us. And it is the journey to take. It is the Jesus journey. Jesus took that journey, and we get to take that journey, and it's something to be embraced. I've said this phrase a lot the whole time I've been here. And people that were on the leadership team at the very beginning, Todd, you were in the leadership team at the very beginning, you remember these words. I said this at the very beginning. Who you are is more important than what you do, and it's out of who you are that God will do great things in and through you. Who we are is more important than anything we'll do. Because it's out of who we are that God will do great things in us and through us. Identity is huge. Knowing who we are. Who am I? Who are you? Who are we? It is a question we have to ask. And as I said last week, a real cheesy quote, when we get our who right, we will get our do right. So, how many of you have watched that show, The Masked Singer? Anybody watch it? Weird show. First time I watched it, I could not figure out what was going on. But they basically take a celebrity who puts on the most audacious, is that a word? Audacious costume that you wouldn't even expect. And they come out and sing, and then there's a panel that tries to figure out the celebrity who's wearing the costume who's singing the song. And these aren't like professional singers, these are just actors, these are celebrities who happen to be able to sing. I remember the one I watched, the very first one, the person came out in this bunny costume, this huge, you know, like a mascot bunny costume, and then sings, and they're trying to figure out who the person is behind it. I think that life is an identity crisis for us. I think it is. I mean, from the day we're born, we're trying to figure out who we are. Right? If you go through your whole life, we're in an identity crisis. We're trying to figure out who we are. Who am I? And then who am I now? And then who am I now? I mean, think about it. Grade school, middle school, high school. You're in college, maybe not college. You're trying to figure out a career, marriage, not marriage, parenting. Who am I now? Kids leave the house, empty nest. Who am I now? Midlife crisis, who am I now? I mean, it's constant. Who am I? Who am I? And we're always looking out here. We're always looking out here to determine who we are. And our circumstances, in so many cases, are defining who we are. And I think today, in our culture right now, we're even in more of an identity crisis. Because if you identify one way, if you come out one way, like I voted for, right? I mean, identity. We get hit. So we're even keeping more of ourselves hidden because if I come out about this, you'll push back and then I won't have a relationship with you. So we're even hiding more of who we are, I believe, than we ever have before. It doesn't feel as safe. It doesn't feel comfortable. And so we're in this deep identity crisis. And most of the time, it's out of fear of being rejected. Life's biggest question is, who am I? And we have to realize that question is always being asked. We're always asking that question, whether it's consciously or subconsciously. It's always there. And our life always flows out of how we answer that question. E.E. Cummings said this, "To be nobody but yourself in a world which is doing its best day and night to make you everybody else means to fight the hardest battle which any human being can fight and never stop. In other words, the world out there is trying to get us to be like them. And it's a fight that we have all the time because we want to fit. And I think it's because we don't know who we are. We have forgotten who we are. I believe awareness is the battle. The more aware you are, the more victory that you will have in it. So I read this great book this week called Who God Says You Are. By Klein Snodgrass, and I'll send some links out in terms of the these books. And in this book, he talked about 9 factors that determine our identity as we live our lives. These are factors that determine who we are, whether we acknowledge it or not. Okay. And again, I'll post these so you have them. Our body, first of all, this body we've been given, is a huge factor in identity. Tall, short, fat, skinny, black, white, brown. This body determines our identity. In the world, it's a huge factor, right? We've all experienced it. The way the world views this body determines a whole lot. And even the way we view ourselves. It shapes our identity, just the way we look. Some of us have been born with disabilities or handicaps. That shapes our identity, whether we acknowledge it or not. Second factor is our history, our story, just our life story. Whatever your story is determines your identity. We all have a story. And it has shaped who we are. And for many of us, we identify ourselves too much with that story, especially the negative stuff that's been in there. And then in some cases, if it's been a whole lot of success the other way, we can identify ourselves wrong as well. Because pride can be there. A third factor is just our relationships, the relationships we've had with people, with one another. Our relationships shape our identity hugely. I mean, if you had a great mom and dad growing up, that shapes who you are. If you had a terrible mom and dad growing up, or the lack of one of those, it shapes who you are. It shapes how you view yourself. Another one is commitments. It's another factor. The things we commit ourselves to. I am committed to this, and that thing we commit ourselves to shapes our identity. And in some cases, that could be a really good thing. But if you commit yourself to wrong things, then it can shape your identity in a negative way. Our actions, the things that we do, and the choices that we make, shape our identity. I mean, we get to make choices each and every day to the things that we're going to do. And it does shape our identity, the things that we choose to do each day. Some of those are long-term actions, and some of them are just a short-term decision we make. Another one is our boundaries. The boundaries that we have in place shape our identity. The things that I will do and the things I won't do. And for many of us, those boundaries have been so fixed that maybe it's hurt our identity. And for some of us, we've had no boundaries. And that has shaped our identity as well and affected who we are. A few more. Change. How we change and evolve. We're people that are always being reformed, whether you notice it or not. As you go through life, you're being formed and formed and formed. And in biblical words, we can say we're being transformed. As we experience things, our lives can change us, and it affects who we are. The future, the way we look at our future ahead, is a factor in who we think we are and how I look ahead. And then lastly is our interpretation and memory of everything that happens to us. And I think that's one of the biggest factors, is as we experience life, how do I interpret it? When I have this happen to me, how am I reading it? Or my memories, how do I remember that? Okay, I don't know if you have this in your family, but I have a brother and sister, and my brother and I have memories of life a certain way, and then my sister has memories of that life a different way. And I scratch my head sometimes. Oh, wait, I was there. I grew up in the same house. And yet, your view of the memory is completely different. Okay, all those factors shape us. So, as followers of Jesus, you need to remember that we have been invited by him to follow him, to live like him. And that has to be rooted in our identity, our real identity, the people that God created us to be, who we really are. Jesus came to remind us of who we are, to redeem all that we're not, to show us who God created us to be so that we can live into the abundance of who we are and all that God has for us. So who are we? So let's turn to Jesus. Don't worry, I'm not going to preach through this whole text here. Because it speaks. I've said this before, as we read scripture, it's a living word and it speaks. And I'm going to read this passage, this chunk. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3. It says your bulletin 8, but you know, I spent time with it this week. Half the bulletin was printed, so I'm going to 11. Sorry. Okay. But I want you to listen to these words. see what stands out to you, okay? I'm going to read these, but I'm curious for yourself, what stands out to you, and then I'll share just some words that stood out to me. All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Even before he made the world, God loved us and chose us in Christ to be holy and without fault in his eyes. God decided in advance to adopt us into his own family by bringing us to himself through Jesus Christ. This is what he wanted to do, and it gave him great pleasure. So we praise God for the glorious grace he's poured out on us who belong to his dear Son. He is so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his Son and forgave our sins. He has showered us. He has showered his kindness on us, along with all wisdom and understanding. God has now revealed to us his mysterious plan regarding Christ, a plan to fulfill his own good pleasure. And this is the plan. At the right time, he'll bring everything together under the authority of Christ. Everything in heaven and on earth. Furthermore, because we are united with Christ, we have received an inheritance from God. For he chose us in advance, and he makes everything work out according to his plan. It says right at the very beginning, because of Jesus, we have every spiritual blessing you could ever want. All of it. Everything that we want because of Jesus we can have. He's already blessed us with it. And my first question is, why do we live in that? Why don't we live in the full blessing that God has already got right there for me? Listen to these words. It says, we are loved. We are loved. When you don't feel loved, you're forgetting that God loves you. We're loved. I'll be honest, I sit there sometimes and go, what was he? Appetite. We are chosen. How many times in life have you been sitting there and you've never been chosen? God chose you. It says before the world began, he chose you. We are holy and without fault. How many times do we blame ourselves and we struggle with life? We are holy and without fault because of Jesus. God looks at us through the cross. He looks at us as fully redeemed and restored. He looks at us through Jesus, holy and without fault. I mean, how many times are we kicking ourselves? And God looks at us. We are holy and without fault. We are adopted. You don't have family? You got family. You're part of a bigger family. You're part of the family. He's adopted us when we have felt forsaken. We are his pleasure. You give God pleasure. Think about that. We are recipients. And Paul used these words, showered, poured out on us. We are recipients, which means we have to receive it. Overflowing grace, kindness, wisdom, and understanding. That's all ours to have. We are free. Free of any burdens we have. Are free. You want to seek freedom? It's found in Jesus. We're forgiven. We're a part of this plan. We are heirs, which means everything that God has is ours. And I love this. It's what I hold on to. Is we have lives that will work out according to his plan. Our lives are going to work out. God's not done yet. Our lives are going to work out. To know this stuff that I just read off in any relationship with another human being, and you get to live into the fullness of that, it's a game changer. I think. To be around people who are identifying themselves with that, this is our identity. You have an insert in your bulletin, and I want you to take it home. I want you to spend some time with it. Neil Anderson wrote this great book, it's devotional, and I'll share it with you next week. I'll share all these books with you guys as we go along. So you can get them if you want. This is a devotional called Who I Am in Christ. And it's just a list there that goes way beyond what I just said. Take the time this week and sit down. Set aside some quiet time. Sit down and be reminded of who you are. And read those passages of Scripture. There's far more words in there. So, let me end with this. Genesis. God creates us in His image. And the enemy lures humanity away from who they are and says, there's something else. There's God's holding out on you. There's something else. And we know this. First two questions in the Bible that God asks. Where are you? And who told you that? Where are you? And who told you that? We're His kids. We're made in God's image. And I think half the time God's going, Peter, where are you? The person I made, fully you. Where are you? And then I'll point out some things and He'll go, who told you that? God loved us so much that He sent His Son to die for us, to eliminate all sin, to eliminate all ungodliness. I think the greatest sin and the greatest ungodliness that we can live is we aren't, when we aren't living out the people that God created us to be. Each one of you is unique. You are unique, and you're not supposed to be like anybody else. You're not. We need to live into who we really are. And it is a journey to take. So, this week, just reflect on this. What's preventing you from living into who you know God has made you to be? Or maybe I just put you in a dilemma right now where you're like, oh my, I'm a mess. Where do I even begin? Ask, Father, if you were going to point out something in my life right now that's not of you, that you'd love to see me live in the beauty of, what is that? And just ask that question. And I know this, that when you do that, He answers. All right. So that's what I had to share this morning. I'm on this journey with you. So I'm going to ask you, what did you hear this morning? As I always do. And what do you sense God is asking you to do with what you heard?
serious love that Jesus laid down in his life so that we could live. It's very deep. He did it for you. And he did it for me. He did it for us. How deep the Father's love. Perfect we can be sometimes. Oh Lord, forgive us for getting caught up in so many different things, letting the world define who we are, and losing ourselves in the process. Oh Lord, I pray that you would help each one of us to know deep, deep within our soul how much you love us, that we may know how much you have for us, that when we hear words like, we are your beloved, we are your pleasure, to hang out, and even if you're curious about TJ, you want to hang out with us after, we're going to be in the back in a little bit. And anybody needs some prayer this morning, I'll be over here by the gate. I'll pray for you. So have a great day, and go Niners. And I will throw this out there. I don't like watching Niner games alone, so you can like go, hey Peter, come to my house to watch the Niner game, or Peter, I'm coming to your house to watch the Niner game. Either way.